In this video I will tell something about this return loss bridge that I built, also called a Wheatstone bridge, bridge of Wheatstone. Enjoy! If we have two voltage dividers like this, we have a voltage here, and suppose all resistors are the same value, then we have here the voltage half of the total voltage, we have here the voltage half of the total voltage, and between those two points there's no voltage difference. So as long as all the resistors are the same, this circuit is in balance and there's no difference in the voltage. That is in principle this theory. If we have the same circuit as just explained, but you don't know what this resistor is, we can do it via connector to outside and then make a connector, a resistor on it. Then you can, when everything is in balance, you don't have voltage here, but if this resistor differs from the rest, you see some voltage here. If you don't do DC power here, but HF or higher, then it is all the same. And you can, when these are low impedance resistors, and this is all smooth and neatly, then you can measure the impedance of what is connected here. The only problem is, this one is not related to common. So you cannot measure it from here to here, or from here to here. You have to measure between them. And so this is imbalance. So you need a balun here. For HF it is not so difficult to make a balun, such a toroid, but for much higher frequencies we need to have more even easier balun. It is made by seam rigid coax cable, and several of these cores and if you can see it, one semi-rigid coax is the shielding is connected here and the inner core is connected there, and the other doesn't even have to be a coax cable, it could be a straight wire in parallel. And then many of these cores passing through. And here is the signal going out. This one is connected to the ground. And this is the device and the test. So we need a connector here, we need a connector here, and we need a connector here for the HF signal in. We have to shield it all. So I took a copper pipe and this doesn't fit in. But with the vise you can make it another shape, that you can make several of those in it. And then the most difficult part, these resistors needs to be very small, otherwise they have too much inductive. So you have to solder those, in my case SMD resistors, here to a heavy copper. That's difficult. So you can make here first some shielding, copper shielding or so, that you solder it here, and then you have much thinner material to solder the SMD resistors on. The resistors itself I did 200 ohm in parallel, so this is 100 ohm in parallel, this is 100 ohm in parallel, these also, so 50 ohm, 50 ohm, 50 ohm, and if this device in the test is also 50 ohm, then you get nothing out of here, because then there's no difference. If this is unbalanced, so for example you connect nothing, then you see signal coming out of here. That's the principle, and that's the practical way I did it.
I made a macro photo to show what is inside, how I made it. You see some foil that was needed to make it possible to solder the SMD components to the heavy body of the copper tube. It conducts heat so easy that it is difficult to solder, and also it is possible, it is now more preventing mechanical stress to the components, because the copper foil is a bit flexible, so it makes it more stable.
But then you have to calibrate it. You can use as an HF in a noise generator, so you come with a whole spectrum of signals and you look with the spectrum analyzer what is coming out. You can also have some signal that is sweeping over the band and look at the spectrum analyzer what comes out. I did it with my NWT6000, and you first have to calibrate it. This is how I hooked it up to the NWT6000. This is the return loaf bridge with the HF out coming from the button, and it's going to the input of the device, and the output, so the signal, is going to the HF in, and this connector is the device in the test. And because I used SMA connectors, I needed an adapter, because my dummy load that is going to high frequency is with an end connector. Calibration is always done with the connector and or cable that is connected to the measured, to be measured object. In this case with the NWT6000, I do the calibration with this 40 dB attenuator, as explained in the other movie.
With the open end connector I get this line on top, purple, and I now connected the dummy load and see what will be shown in the graph. And that's this, and it's not a very good reflection coefficient, because we need at least minus 20 dB to have a proper indication. And we are now here going too high, so it is used less above, say, 2.5 gigahertz. So that's not so good. I now connected my indoor inverted V antenna and I wobble it, so you see it real time. This is the frequency and the depth. If you are more in for SWR, there are calculators on the web. You key in the return loss, in this case 13.7, and after clicking on calculate you see the SWR 1.5. And as another small demonstration, I show the LPA antenna that is connected directly to the return loss bridge, showing this graph. If I move my hand nearby, you see that it is moving around all. And you see the dipoles back in the dips that are not at the places at the amateur bands. So the design could have been better. This is all shown by this return loss bridge. Enjoy building one. And if you like this video, you can subscribe to my channel or look at my channel if I have already some videos that you like.